shade till he should see what would become the city. And the Lord God appointed a plank and made it come up over Jonah, that it might be a shade over his head, to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was exceedingly glad because of the plank. But when dawn came up the next day, God appointed a worm which attacked the plank, so that it withered. When the sun rose, God appointed a sultry east wind, and the sun beat upon the head of Jonah, so that he was faint. And he asked that he might die, and said, "It is better for me to die than to live." But God said to Jonah, "Do you do well to be angry before the plank?" And he said, "I do well to be angry, angry enough to die." And the Lord said, "You pity the plank for which you did not labor, nor did you make it grow, which it came into being in the night and perished in the night. And should not I pity Nineveh, that great city, in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know their right hand from their left, and also much cattle?" The word of the Lord.
Thank you. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
grace is God's giving us what we don't deserve. God's giving us what our sins would not deserve. Mercy, of course, is sort of a corollary term, and we hear a lot, and we use it a lot. We're going to pray here in just a moment in the confession of sin, and we'll all say together, "Have mercy upon us, have mercy upon us, most merciful Father." And of course, the word mercy means God sparing us, or not giving us what we deserve, or what our sins deserve. And so, in our Old Testament reading today, I feel a little bit like my assistant, Father Joseph. He's been going through his study for a long, long time now, the Old Testament prophets. This is really more his specialty, but I'm going to venture into those a little. I don't usually talk about the Old Testament reading much, but I want to talk to you today primarily, actually, about the book of Jonah and the Old Testament reading that we have from it. We all know the story. If you grew up, as I did, in Sunday school and children's church, you sang songs about who didn't swallow Jonah, all those sorts of things. You probably colored it in a coloring book. You knew that story from you. It's a captivating story. It's so captivating that it's even been captured by the Walt Disney Company in film in different ways. It's a really compelling story. What happened with Jonah? What's the story all about? Usually the Old Testament prophets are called to go either to the northern kingdom, Israel, the 10 northern tribes that make up the nation of Israel, with a message of warning or woe, or sometimes a message of blessing, a message of encouragement, a message of God's promise. Sometimes the Old Testament prophets are sent to the southern two tribes, known as the nation Judah, centered around Jerusalem in the southern part of the Holy Land. And again, those prophets oftentimes go with a message of woe. Sometimes they go with a message of weal. Sometimes they have incredible promises. Sometimes they have very strong warnings. But what doesn't happen most of the time is that most of the time the prophets are not sent to other countries, other peoples. Their focus is usually on those within the covenant people of God, those who are part of the promises that God has made to Israel, his people, that he has sealed with covenant, that he has sealed with what we would think of as Old Testament sacraments, if you will, like, for instance, circumcision, which is that badge and that seal of the promise that God made to Abraham all those many generations ago. None of those things are true about Jonah's message, his calling. Jonah is called to go to Nineveh. Nineveh is a near neighbor, but it's not part of the covenant people of God. They've not received the promises. They've not been given the law. They've not been given the temple and the sacrifices and the priesthood and all those things that are God's unique revelations and gifts to his covenant people of Israel. So Jonah goes to the Ninevites. Well, no, wait a second. Let me back up just a second. He doesn't go right away, does he? Now, we know the story. He actually gets in a ship and heads the opposite direction. It's very clear in the Old Testament book of the prophet Jonah that he doesn't want to be called. Oftentimes, that's me. I'll confess it. A lot of times I don't want to do what it is that God's calling me to do because it's difficult. It's outside my comfort zone. It's painful, perhaps, in some way. Jonah doesn't want to do this. He doesn't want to go to Nineveh. What's his message that he's given to go preach to the Ninevites? It's a message of repentance. It's a message of grace and mercy. If you will repent and turn to the Lord, he'll be merciful to you. He'll forgive you your sins. And that is a message, again, that's a little bit surprising, perhaps, to us as we read the Old Testament. Because usually that message is concentrated on God's covenant people of Israel. But now it's being shared with these near neighbors who are Gentile pagans, like me and my family. A very surprising thing. Jonah doesn't want to do it. Jonah doesn't want to share that message. It's very clear. Don't trust Joel Hampton on this. Go read the book of Jonah. You can do it all in an hour or less. It's a very short book. Jonah doesn't want to go to Nineveh and preach this message because he's afraid the Ninevites will hear it and heed it. He's afraid they'll repent and turn to the Lord. Now, perhaps you have felt that way about somebody else. Maybe today. Notice again here in just a moment when we say together the confession of sin, we don't ask God, please give me everything I deserve. Please, justice, God, I want you to pour it out. Give me what I've got coming. We ask God to be merciful to us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful. By the way, Jonah is a human being. We know later he turns from his own error and he is restored to a right relationship with God. So I don't want to freeze him like a fly in amber. He's always being this bigoted person that doesn't want the Ninevites to repent. But at one point in his life, that's exactly who he is. He doesn't want God to be merciful to the Ninevites because they're strangers, they're foreigners, they're aliens, and people are exiles and strangers to the covenants of Israel, all those sorts of things. Uncircumcised people. So after spending some time heading the wrong direction, ending up in the belly of a great fish and being vomited up on the shores of Nineveh, Jonah finally gets around to doing what it is that God calls him to do. And again, by true confessions, isn't that us so often? Don't we always take the most circuitous route oftentimes in following God's commandment, and then eventually we get there, okay, God, I'll do what it is that you wanted me to do all along. Well, Jonah preaches a message of repentance to the Ninevites, and wonder of wonders, they repent in dust and ashes. And so Jonah is jubilant. He rejoices that these people have, like himself, found God, found forgiveness, found God's infinite mercy and goodness and graciousness. No, he's mad, as Grandma used to say, as a wet man. In fact, he's madder than that. He asked God to die. Notice the book of Jonah spends a great deal of time painting a very careful portrait of Jonah's character, and he sounds like everybody I've ever known in my life, including the man that I see when I look in the mirror. Jonah is more concerned about the plant in our reading today than he is 120,000 Ninevites who are outside the covenant, outside the promises of God, who need this message. Well, there's so much that we can say. The book of Jonah is so fascinating. The story is so deep in its theology, but I'll save some of that for another sermon. Let me just say, Jonah finally gets the message. God is saying to Jonah, I want to show the same mercy to the Ninevites. I want to show the same grace. I want to extend my love to these uncircumcised heathen in the same way that I had to you and to your people, my covenant people, Israel. Jonah has to learn this lesson. By the way, this is buried way back in the Old Testament, hundreds and hundreds of years before Christ. It's the same message that we read today in the Gospel reading. Let me say, as I do every time this passage comes up, and it comes up very frequently in our lectionary readings, Jesus is not teaching us economic theory. Those of you who are employers, please don't treat your employees the way that the parable has these folks. I think you probably not have any employees if you pay them all the same regardless of how little or much that they work. What's Jesus' point? It's very simply this, that God's grace is extended to all who will receive it. Whether you have worked in the heat of the day and the scorching sun, or whether you come at the 11th hour and you just barely worked up a sweat before the day ends, God's grace extends to all of us. Now let's bring this home to where we live today. Who of us within the confines of these four walls today deserve God's grace? Who of us here today deserves God's mercy? I'll be the first to say, as your rector, I don't. I'll pray that same confession of sin with you. I need God to be merciful to me, to be a merciful Father, because my sins deserve what? My sins deserve what Jesus suffered on the cross, which we see right there as a focal point of this entire space where we worship every single time we come in here. Jesus hangs in agony on the cross because Joel Hansen's sins put him there. Jesus hangs in agony on the cross struggles, they've got problems, they've got bills to pay, they've got difficulties they're dealing with. The biggest thing that should cause you to be gracious to everyone you encounter is they're sinners like you. And they need to hear God's message of love, His message of forgiveness. They need to experience His gracious renewal of their lives. And again, we've heard that over and over again, even in this Mass today, and we will as long as we are part of the church militant. So today, as Jonah was given the message to go to Nineveh, I give you a message today of repentance. God calls you to confess your sins, to turn from them, and return to Him. He promises you His gracious forgiveness, His mercy, and His goodness. So that, for us today, is incredibly good news. Despite whatever you may have read in the newspaper this morning, despite what you might see on the television this evening, God wants to show His grace and His mercy to people like you and like me who least deserve it because of His infinite goodness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Prayers for free. Hear our prayer.
Purely unintentional. St. Matthew, not only is he the writer of the first gospel in our New Testament, he's also an apostle, and as such, is one of our patron saints. And we have Mass over here at the Lady Altar at 6 p.m. tomorrow for St. Matthew, the apostle and evangelist. And I trust that you'll join us in person or perhaps online, and continuing with all of our public liturgies to put those on Facebook Live. And you're welcome to join us that way if you'd like as well. We have a Trunk or Treat coming up on the 24th of October, and we still need to know if you're going to participate in that. You can talk to this lady, Tracy, today, or you can also contact us at the parish office. We really would like to be able to share something with our friends and neighbors in the area. And so the 24th, Saturday the 24th of October, Trunk or Treat. Talk to Tracy or call us on the email or email us in the office if you want to be a part of that.
Well, we're still looking far short for us to be able to justify having it. So please, 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 if you're willing, let me know where the office so we can either get it on the books or take it off.
Thank you. Let me also address, since I've got a captive audience here for a second, just so there's no confusion, when we put out the messages about how there's extra chairs out, you're welcome to sit in those, and I'm glad to see people availing themselves of that option. Contrary to rumors that have come to me, the Lady Chapel is not reserved for a special class of citizens. You don't have to be able to trace yourself, your family back to the Mayflower, or anything like that. It's anyone who wants to sit over there can. Yes, some of our servers and their families like to sit there, but if you're concerned about a place to sit that's comfortable and a good distance, that's a great place to sit over there. So thank you, as I say often, for your continued cooperation with all of our efforts to try to mitigate the spread of COVID-19. And God bless you all for being here. Anything else we need to mention, Mr. Senior Warden? Okay, I can't think of anything. Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name, bring offerings, and come to his court.
Thank you. is his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that he may evermore dwell in him, and he in us.
Thank you. Amen.
Thank you.
perpetual shine upon them. Amen. Amen.